Okay, I think we'll get started here tonight. It's August 10th, and we've been away from board meetings for about 6 weeks, and it's fun to come back for the August session because we're starting out with a spotlight for our students who earned an IB or International Baccalaureate Diploma. So we're going to start by recognizing our diploma earners. Lots of students took IB classes during the year. And Rob, do you want to introduce our coordinator? Are you going to say something about Greg?
I would love to. We have a new IB coordinator this year. Her name is Jenny Magdahl. And Jenny, you can make your way up to the microphone. While she's heading up there, I'll tell you a story about our previous IB diploma coordinator, Greg Goddard. Greg graduated from St. Louis Park High School, came back to teach at St. Louis Park High School. And for the next 3 years, he's going to be working in Ghana as a principal slash IB coordinator with his wife, Sally, who is also a park grad and a park teacher. And so 3 years away in Africa for the Goddards, and then they'll come back to teach in St. Louis Park. And it's a perfect IB story because we're always looking at multiple perspectives and different points of view, and to spend time working in a different country and coming back will just add to the great benefits of International Baccalaureate here in St. Louis Park. So in the meantime, Jenny Magdahl is here. And Jenny, do you want to take a moment to introduce yourself and what you do here besides being the IB coordinator?
Excellent. Thank you, Superintendent Metz. And thank you to the school board as well as to the community members that are here tonight and the parents for allowing me this chance to help and honor our IB 2015 diploma recipients. It's a huge honor that they've incurred, and I'm happy to be here with you all. I've been in the district for 10 years teaching chemistry and science 9. In the past 5 years, I've been teaching IB chemistry, which is taught starting in 10th grade. So I've kind of been the gateway class to the IB diploma program, and I've always felt that kind of responsibility trying to teach the IB learner profile and what it is to have theory of knowledge. And so I've been thinking in that mindset, and also the NHS coordinator, and see this as the perfect link in to everything. Now I'll be able to connect with more students and hopefully get the community within St. Louis Park more geared towards the IB, which we would be wonderful with the MYP and the PYP that we have now. This year, 2015, was a record-breaking year for us. We had 241 students taking a total of 491 IB exams. That's just juniors and seniors. 241. But the eight students that we are recognizing tonight go far beyond just taking a few tests. They had to complete three SL courses. Those SL courses are a year and a half to 2 years in length. They had to take three HL courses. All of those HL courses are 2 years in length. They took a theory of knowledge test or class, which is like thinking about thinking. They've completed a 4,000 word research report of their own choosing, something that they were passionate about. And they completed as well 150 hours of community and service projects, community action and service projects. So they've done remarkable things while they've been here. It's no small feat that they've all earned this. All of these experiences have included the global focus and global perspective, as well as the characters of the learner profile. And clearly, these IB recipients are going to have a clear advantage as they begin their college and their adventures outside of St. Louis Park. So we have three of our eight recipients here today. The students who were unable to be here include Ori Etzion, Addy Mae Perkins, who received a bilingual diploma, which means that she's fluent in two different languages, Rachel Potter, Elliot Schwartz, and Miranda VanPilsum-Johnson. Now, Miranda sent off a little note that I'd like to read for you all. So from Miranda, she says, "To me, the IB program was not simply a system of rigorous education, but an atmosphere in which I was exposed to the diverse thought processes of an amazing group of peers. Out of all the time I spent under the umbrella of IB, the most rewarding moments were those in which I discovered new perspectives simply by listening to the thoughts and opinions of other IB students. The intelligence enclosed by my IB classroom was immense, but the excitement of the flow of new ideas was even more so. So in truth, what IB really meant to me was the chance to understand new ways of thinking and to turn to obtain a balanced mind. Thank you, Miranda, if you hear this. Thank you for writing that for us. I'd like to start inviting our recipients up. What I'll have you do when I call your name, you'll come up here, tell us your little story about IB as well. Tell us where you're headed and what you plan to do in the future. And we're gonna start out with Alejandra Campos, who also got the bilingual diploma. Congratulations.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for having me here. I'm here with my mom, Rosemary Gonzalez, and my little sister, Daniela Campos. They've been the biggest support for me throughout these years and throughout my whole life, but especially high school, because they were the ones who stayed up with me every single night that I had to write an essay or just gave me the support when I was crying for help. So Ms. Magdal asked us what IB meant to us. And to me, IB has meant more than just learning. It has also meant a family for me. The reason why I decided to take IB is because I was born in Colombia, and I was promised to learn more about the world through this program, which I'm glad I did. I learned about different points of view, communism, something that is frowned upon some days. I also learned to look from other people's points of view. Some of my classmates, I didn't share their opinions, but they're opinions that I value now. I've learned so many things from them, just like Miranda. I echo her own words because that was my personal experience as well. But IB also meant family. It meant people who I was able to be with, people who supported me every step of the way, and people who I learned so much with. Not only academically, but also personally, they helped me grow. Like Ms. Magdal mentioned, we had to write a 4,000-word essay. It was probably one of the hardest things I've done academically. It was a whole year and a half of writing, researching, and quite honestly, cramming at the end. But I took upon a topic that was very interesting to me at the moment, female suffrage in England and how it came about. I learned a lot, but it was more than I learned academically, but more, it meant to me learning new skills, skills that I was actually able to put in practice this summer. I was lucky enough to be selected to take a course of English at my university. And we're here, I had a whole year and a half to write a research essay. This summer I only had a week and a half to write a research essay. I'm very glad I took IB, to be honest. And this is what I take with me. When I started IB, people told me you're gonna really be happy when you get to college because you have the skills, you have the knowledge, you can talk to people from around the world because you know what's going on. And it's true. And I just wanna thank the school for having this program for us because it really meant the world and it changed me. Thank you very much.
Hey, before you leave, can you tell us if you have college plans and what they might be?
Oh, yeah, sorry. So I will be attending Yale University this fall. I plan on majoring in Latin American studies and do some work with Spanish in the legal school. Thank you very much.
Next up, we have Aaron Goodman.
Second while I pull up my notes. So this is my dad, David, and my mom, Rita. Thank you for supporting me throughout the IB experience and high school experience. So IB has been rewarding to me in a multitude of ways. Of course, the community, which made the high school experience much more rewarding and much more interesting throughout the 2 years through the IB diploma, and also the academic challenge, which will hopefully help prepare me, especially in time management skills and transitioning and being a student athlete at a school like Carleton. So other than that, IB was, especially through challenges like TOK and extended essay, really I think it'll help me in my college experience and in large research papers and class discussions where you need to do reading and research beforehand before sharing your ideas with the class. So these skills I learned through the IB program and TOK, extended essay, and courses like IB History will help me in the future. And I plan to go to Carleton College next year and study political science and economics.
Peter Johnson.
Hi. I'd first like to extend my deepest gratitude to my family. My mom, Kathy, is here tonight, along with my father, Brent. They gave me the support I needed throughout high school and throughout my entire life and continuing forward with where I go. And they've always been supportive of what I want to do and have really helped me achieve that. The IB program, I think, really encapsulates what's important for high school students in learning independence. A lot of the courses, like IB History, or theory of knowledge, or working on the extended essay, allowed people, students, to have independence in terms of researching and doing their work. And they were accountable for turning in their work, and there was much less hand-holding, I think, which I think was fantastic and really benefited me personally in time management and organizing and really looking ahead and what I'm doing, studying these things and why I'm studying them. And I really believe that for college, it is a great experience for high school students, and I really appreciate that the school district offered me that opportunity, along with the fantastic teachers here at Park, that made that opportunity really turn into a fantastic experience that let me grow as an individual and as a scholar. I can just keep it brief. I think that Alejandra and Aaron really summed up great in how the IB diploma managed to help. I plan to major in diplomacy and world affairs and potentially go further on into law at Occidental College, which is in Los Angeles. Thank you.
If the two students could come back up here and Peter stay here so we can take a picture of the group, please. Now, I know as we walked up here tonight, all the students were thinking, I really don't want to go, because they saw all the floors are being polished, the paint's coming, being redone, everything's being spiffed up for back to school. But if you're really going to go on to college, you're welcome to leave now. You don't have to stay for the rest of the meeting. Or you can if you want to. But thank you and congratulations to all of you. I really, truly believe you'll find the benefit of your IB diploma, and all of our students who took even one of the courses, I'm sure, will see the benefit of that as they go forward. So thank you. Feel free to leave if you'd like. And we will go on to the regular meeting tonight. And let me pull out our agenda. I will call this meeting to order. And our agenda is first the approval of the agenda, followed by open forum, an opportunity for our community to make comments, the superintendent's report. Then there are seven items on our discussion agenda, including the superintendent evaluation, student data, the ATPPS annual plan review and request for approval, the strategic plan update, the Minnesota State High School League resolution for membership for 2015-16, truth and taxation report, and policy development, first reading of a series of many policies, board policies. Then there is the consent agenda. Then we have an action agenda, which is the approval of the date for the truth and taxation hearing. Second is the Minnesota State High School League resolution for membership. And third is the approval of the ATPPS 2015-16 plan. And the fourth item that is on the agenda, we can include in that motion a move to table, as we do not need to address that tonight. There's communications and transmittals, and finally adjournment. So is there a motion to approve the agenda? And I would ask that you clarify, which if you include tabling item 7D.
Yeah, I move to approve the agenda and table item 7D as in dog.
Second from Bruce.
Jim.
I looked and who was moving? So second from Jim. Any discussion? Then all in favor of the motion to approve the agenda and table item 7D, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? Motion carries, and we have an agenda for the evening. So the first item is open forum, and Cindy, we don't have anybody who has signed up, and we have two employees and one observer, so our audience has gone. We will move past that to the superintendent's report.
Thank you. As part of the strategic planning process this year, a new term was developed, and the new term was a Metspectation. The board members have a copy of what a Metspectation is in front of them. We're keeping out of total public view yet in case we change these Metspectations. But it started as a little bit of humor, but then as the discussion continued, it seemed that it might be a good way to communicate to our staff what is really important from my point of view as superintendent, and that we could use it as a kickoff to the school year this year. It's slightly humorous, but also serious about what's really important to me and how I feel we can move this school district beyond even the great level that it's already at. So we spent some time creating this list of Metspectations, and they align very well with our strategic plan that we just finished writing. So I'm going to read what we have here tonight that we're planning to use in our back-to-school kickoff meeting with staff. Definition is the belief that the school year will be successful when all staff members work together to complete the following. Each individual will understand their role and take action to close the racial achievement gap, provide an equitable educational experience for all learners, deliver outstanding customer service, lean into change and run toward the challenges we face, honor the past and embrace the future, and live the core values of the 2015 to 2020 strategic plan. These Metspectations are internal for now, but they may show up on some staff t-shirts or some window clings. They may be visible around the district at the beginning of the school year as a way to help us kick off the year. We are thrilled to begin a new school year very soon. This is August 10th. And the new year is coming fast. It'll be the 125th year of the St. Louis Park School District. The first day of school is scheduled for Tuesday, September 8th for grades 1 through 12, and Thursday, September 10th for kindergarten. We can't wait for it to begin.
Okay, we will move on to the first discussion item, which is the superintendent evaluation summary. We met earlier for more detail, and I'll turn that over to our vice chair, Joe.
Okay. So, yeah, as the chair stated, we met before to talk about the superintendent's evaluation for the 2014-15 school year, and the process is essentially that Superintendent Metz does his own evaluation based on criteria that we set forth beforehand. The board also takes a look at those criteria and ranks the superintendent on certain management characteristics as well as achievement of goals that were set forth for that school year, this past school year. And we'll do the same thing this coming year. So once I got the results from the superintendent as well as the board, I compiled them, and we met this evening to discuss them. We're very pleased with the superintendent's leadership and the direction of the district. Things are going well. The main strong points that we saw in our ratings were first and foremost the strategic plan. That was revamped this year and will serve us well for the next 5 years. They put the superintendent put together a very diverse group of people to collaborate on that, and the results were excellent, and that's how the entire board saw it. Additionally, the management characteristics were rated very high in terms of relationship with the board, fiscal management, community and public relations was also especially high. Superintendent Metz is out there all the time in the district, at the schools. He's seen, he's listening to people, he's taking advice, and he's collaborating with people. That's a big strength of our superintendent. There was one main area of development, and that was on the criterion for closing the achievement gap. That's certainly one that every school district is struggling with. We see some pockets of success, and those were noted both by the board and the superintendent. The black student graduation rate at the high school is very good. All-day kindergarten results were very good, and we have a lot of students from a variety of backgrounds taking AP and IB classes. That being said, you know, when we look at our MCA results, we would like them to continue to improve and for that gap to narrow. So all in all, a very positive evaluation of the superintendent. We look forward to setting the goals here for the next school year and getting better as we have these first couple of years of his tenure.
Thank you, Joe Totalovich. I forgot to say your last name earlier. And thank you, Superintendent Metz. It's been a great 2 years, and we're looking forward to even more wonderful years in the future, and trust that will occur. So we're look to a positive future. So we'll go back into the present and to some extent last year with our next item, with our student data presentation. And Rob, do you want to introduce Prachee Mukherjee or the presentation generally?
Yes, this is Prachee Mukherjee. She's going to take us through some data from last year and even give us a little bit of new data for this upcoming school year.
We should note, in case anybody notices this by watching on TV, we have new technology in this room, which we trust will be more reliable than in the past, and they're fancier and better screens around here, and which is exciting, but this is also the first time out with it. So we beg everybody's patience as we connect projectors and computers and everything for the first time. And it seems to be connecting, and that was fast. Yay! Go, Tom. Yeah, don't go too far, Tom. But great. So we'll turn it over to our Director of Assessment and Evaluation, Prachee Mukherjee.
Thank you, Julie. Thank you. Good evening, board members and everybody else who's watching. I'm going to present our district's results on the most recent spring state tests, also known as Minnesota Comprehensive Assessments. So why do we do the Minnesota Comprehensive Assessments? The state uses these tests in order to fulfill the federal mandate that we have a standards-based state accountability system, and it's part of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, ESEA. About less than 2% of our students take an alternative test, which is known as the Minnesota Test of Academic Skills, and students with severe cognitive challenges are able to qualify for this test. But the bulk of our students statewide take the MCAs. MCA is administered in two subjects that we are accountable for, math and reading. We also give it in science, but that's not part of our AYP Adequate Yearly Progress or the other reports that are published with our results. So MCA 3 reading was first administered in 2013. In its current version, the third version, it's been with us since 2013 to grades 3, 8, and 10, 3 through 8 and 10. And the test is designed specifically to assess proficiency and progress on state academic standards in English language arts. And we should also keep in mind that not all standards, not all benchmarks are assessed by MCAs. These standards are also aligned with the Common Core and College and Career Readiness standards. And lastly, these new standards that are currently in place are considered more rigorous than its previous version. And moving on to MCA 3 math, math is also in its third iteration, MCA 3. And it was first administered in 2011 to grades 3 through 8, and then grade 11 first received the MCA 3s in 2014. These tests are also designed to assess proficiency and progress on 2007 mathematics standards. And the standards that were replaced, which were from 2003, a big difference between 2003 and 2007 math standards is how algebra now appears at an earlier grade level, so that by the end of eighth grade, students must have completed 1 year of algebra. Now, just a word about academic standards and MCAs. They might appear arbitrary, but they're not. For the standards, teachers, parents, national experts, school boards, business and community members, a very diverse group of people who have different roles are brought together by the Department of Education, and they revise the academic standards periodically. And as our Director of Teaching and Learning, Carrie Ross, was telling me today, it's no more frequently than every 9 years that these standards are revised. And then districts have 3 years to implement the standards before the new test aligned with the standards is first given to students. And as far as the MCAs are concerned, that also is developed through a collaborative process in terms of what is going to be measured and what kinds of items are going to be asked and what kinds of rigor is going to be used in terms of what does it take to show that a student is proficient. And along with that, there are also psychometricians who make sure that the items are written well in order to measure what we think we're measuring for every student. And the test items that appear on operational tests do not get there until they have been reviewed by teachers, until it has been field tested for 2 years. So there's a very lengthy process which determines how the test looks in its final iteration. So a word about the MCA results that I'm going to share. There are four achievement levels on the MCAs. The exceed standards and meet standards, both of those are considered proficient. Then we also have partially meet standards and does not meet standards. The partially meet standards comes into play in some of our federal accountability mandates. And for today, I'm going to summarize results across all tested grade levels because I'm giving you the district overview. And please remember that each year's data represents a different group of students. M- because these refer to the 2015, the most recent test administration, most of you who have students in school have probably experienced some disruptions because this was the first year that tests were mandated or required to be online. And Pearson was the test vendor, still is the test vendor. There was statewide testing disruptions on multiple dates, as a result of which, per legislative requirements, the Department of Education contracted a third-party evaluator known as HUMRO that assessed the impact of disruptions, but it only looked at disruptions on a particular date. There were many reasons why the study was designed the way it was designed, but disruptions on April 21st was the focus of study. There was no evidence that the disruptions on average, that's a very important word, had an impact on student scores. The results did not make any conclusions about impact at individual scores or individual students. And as a result of which, the state has concluded that the state test results were not impacted by disruptions that happened because of online testing. Now, the study did not look at the impact of disruptions that many, many schools experienced, including our schools. For example, delays in loading of test items, which happened not for every student, but for certain students at certain times. That's just one example. Pearson also reached a settlement with MDE for $1 million, and the legislature has asked that MDE present in February what lessons were learned from this experience and what actions were taken as a result. Moving on to our results, I just have some observations about the data before I show it to you. I'm looking at the data over a three-year period for reading, and remember, 2013 was the first year that MCA 3 reading was given to students. Similar to the state, district-wide performance remained constant for all students across the years, with a slight decrease in 2015. So we kind of maintained our pace with the state. And then I'm going to talk about different groups of students disaggregated by race. And this is because NCLB requires us to disaggregate data by race. Our strategic plan's focus is to close the racial achievement gap. World's Best Workforce also requires us to look at the racial achievement gap. And the state has made this a priority. So in comparing students of color and indigenous students, we look at white students kind of as the comparison group. So white students in the district performed higher than their statewide group in all 3 years. And the advantages that they had were respectively 12%, 12%, and 9%. So our district students, white students, performed better than their counterparts statewide. Black students in the district performed similar to the state group, with 2015 being slightly lower than the state. The Asian/Pacific Islander students' proficiency declined in the district and was slightly below the state group, its counterpart statewide, in 2015. Hispanic students' proficiency also declined in the district by 10 percentage points from 2013 to 2015, but in 2015 it was still about 5 percentage points higher than the state. Now for a look at the data. The first row talks about the district, and the second row refers to the state. And we have all students, white students, American Indian students, and that's asterisk because we have a very small number of students, and that doesn't mean that those students are not important to us. However, if we have 20 students or less, then just one student, by one student being proficient or not proficient, has a big impact on the percent proficient. So they're in italics. And then we have Asian Pacific Islander, Hispanic, and Black students.
Prachee, these reflect testing in which grades? Third, fifth, and?
3 through 8 and 10th, because this is reading. And as you can see that our focus on Black students is really justified and very urgent because about a third of our Black students are proficient in reading. compared to when you look at our white students, it's about 80%, close to 80%. Here is another look at the data. This is just a line graph of what you saw, and this only has district results. It doesn't have the state data. And you can see that most of our lines are flat or slightly declining. And when we don't have a large number of students, then we don't take the declines or the upswings that seriously because of the small number of students. And in 2015, we had 17 American Indian, Native American students testing district-wide, 130 Asian Pacific Islander students, 254 Hispanic students, 490 Black students, and about 1373 white students. And that, to me, is a glimpse at how our population is distributed among our white students and students of color and indigenous students. Now, moving on to math, the highlights of our math results. Similar to the state, the district-wide performance remained stable for all students across the years. The white students, again, performed higher than their state-wide a comparison group in all 3 years. The advantage here was slightly lower than reading, 4%, 6%, and 5% points. Black students in the district performed slightly lower than the state group in all 3 years, lagging by 3%, 3%, and 2 percentage points. Just remember that in these 3 years, all the students, grades 3 through 11, grades 3 through 8, received MCA 3 math. But it's only in 2014 and 15 that grade 11 got MCA 3 math. So when you look at 2013, grade 11 is not included because they didn't receive MCA 3 math. Asian Pacific Islander students' proficiency was the same as the state groups, and in 2015, it was 3 percentage points below the state. Hispanic students performed higher than their statewide group in all 3 years with a 6%, 8%, and 6 percentage points advantage. This again is a look at district data compared to state data. And for American Indian students, again, we only had 20 students in 2015. Prior to that, we did not have 20 students. That's the number at which we are held accountable. And once again, you can see that our white students' performance tends to be in the mid-70s compared to our black students who are in the kind of low 30s, not quite mid-30s. That's a line graph of our math data. It shows every student group, and it's only our district data. There's no state data here. And once again, you have the number tested by student group. As you can see, all our lines are pretty flat, except Asian Pacific Islander, which has declined over the 3 years we're looking at. That concludes my presentation. If you have any questions, I can answer them now.
Board members, do you have questions? Ken.
So this is great information. What do we do with this? Not us as a board, but as a school administration, what would we do with this?
So I will share some of the things that we do, and I have other cabinet members there who can also add to this. So one of the more important pieces of information that we look for is the growth information that comes from state tests. And we will receive last year's growth data by the end of September. So when we look at proficiency, we look to see, did our students who were not proficient, did they at least make high growth? That's one of the things we do. When we look at students who were not proficient, then we look at whether those students received any additional interventions or additional support. and that gives us information on did those work. If the students did not move from unproficient to proficient, we look at the growth data to see did it at least help them grow so that they're going to be proficient in another year or a couple of years. We also use the data to see if it confirms or negates other data points, because many of our students also take MAP. And grades 3 through 6, for example, would have taken fall MAP, and that gives them a prediction of whether the student is likely to be proficient or not, so that we see whatever we did with that information, did that make a difference?
Just to clarify for those who are watching or listening, MAP is another assessment that we use that is more useful for our teachers.
Yes, thank you, Julie. It's a district-adopted test that is also adaptive, just like the MCAs are, and it helps the teachers to get more information, additional information, as well as growth information, as well as more current information, because they test the students in the fall. Carrie, would you add to that?
I would add to answer your question, Ken, is tomorrow we're starting a summer leadership academy for building leadership teams to be super intentional this year about using their data to drive decisions, to be looking deeply and meaningfully at data, followed up by our data retreat a couple of years later, or a couple of weeks later, not years. We have a sense of urgency here. We're not waiting 2 years to have this conversation. And then, as Prachee suggested, in the fall, we start meeting with school teams to say, this is what we know to be true now. We have time now to adjust budgets, adjust programs, put the support where we need to be. Where we did that last year, we had great success stories. One of our elementary school principals came to us in the fall and said, it looks like my third grade is not going to be proficient. Enough students are not going to be proficient on the MCAs this spring. What can I do? And we worked together, Prachee, Frida, Bailey, myself, and the building principal, and we reallocated resources and designed some programs, and that grade level scores jumped 20%. So we have to react to the data, not just use the data after the fact.
And I think that's great that we're able to do those things. So we have the data that will go to the student level, student number, whichever. So I'm just looking at the slower level, which is the black students. It looks like about 340 kids aren't making it. So are we able to look at those during this retreat and during this open evaluation of data and see if any of those were getting the double dip, as Karen was talking about, and how effective that is, and or any other programs, and see if we can do anything with those?
Yes, Ken. Schools have already had this data. It was released under an embargoed condition about a month ago. So schools have had this data. It has been loaded into our data warehouse, and we can go down to the student level and see what their past performance was, what classes they were in. So schools have been looking at it, and when they come for the data retreat, they'll be presenting to each other about what they've learned. And you know, when principals present to you the same thing, they talk about what results did they get and why do they think they got those results. But we have some learning to do there in terms of, I got the data, it's not good, what do I do now?
I think that would be really, really interesting. Sorry, last one. I think that would be really, really interesting to be able to see each of the individuals, track where they've been doing over the past years or whatever, and maybe even develop an individual plan for them to progress to the next level or to proficiency and see what that would be. I know it's more of an individual planning for individual students, but I wonder where we're at.
So, Ken, that's a new dimension, actually, that we're adding this year in terms of professional development to dig to that level of the data, and what does that mean? The MAP tests are valuable pieces of information to grow, so are our kids growing, but the reality of it is MCAA tests are the only tests that give us an indication if students have met grade level expectations. So how do we use multiple data points to get to your question about how do I know that kids are learning and kids are being successful, and that is especially our Black students are being set up for success in college and career readiness. So that's a conversation we've had, and there's some things that are added to the data retreat this year that are a precursor to that, and ongoing support for individual teachers, grade levels, principals to be more personal with the data at the student level.
We'll come back, Ken, if there are more. Jim?
That was one of the things, and I felt like this year we were, every year we were trying to get more intentional and trying to find students before the test and using, and that was one of the tools, was using the MAP tests and trying to predict, okay, these kids need some remediation and trying to intervene earlier. And yet we're still pretty flat here. Is it, are we, should we try different interventions? Have we not given enough time? I guess how many years, and I feel like maybe the middle school has been a little more accelerated in trying to identify the students. And I don't know if that matters, but I guess I'm wondering, are we not, are predictive capabilities, are they not accurate? Are they not, or are the interventions not, do we need to tinker with that? Or what, I don't know, and maybe we haven't had time to analyze it enough, but I just feel like, and maybe it hasn't been long enough, but I feel like we've been trying to do that and catch up and do some things, and what's the takeaway?
So I think Prachee will have a better answer for the predictive validity. She has all the great vocabulary to go along with that. I'll just address your comment about the intervention plan at the middle school. Thursday afternoon RTI intervention has been in place for a long time, and it's a great tool for them to have as a building. That's not necessarily going to help us close the racial achievement gap because it's not enough intense instruction. The added component at the middle school for intense intervention, or the second scoop in reading and the second scoop of math, has only been in place for 1 year. The preliminary data in math is very encouraging. We have less gains that we saw in the math program. But we're also adding some instructional coaching pieces for our secondary math teachers, too, to have an embedded coach that will help them. We've seen in past, this past year, where we've embedded instructional coaches intentionally, like in kindergarten or equity coaches, it makes a positive difference. So we're adding those for in terms of teacher interventions, and then we've redesigned some of our student interventions to be more responsive and more nimble with that, too.
So let me follow up. So we've only had it a year. What is a fair amount of time to look back and see, hey, is that second scoop working? Is that the right thing? I mean, would we expect some improvement year two? I mean, should we see this? What's a reasonable expectation if we think it's working?
Well, we did see some improvement this year. So we should see a continual improvement every year. And then after 3 years, we should be at full implementation, have a solid program. We should be having 3 years of student data. We should have 3 years of practice with the program. We should have a scenario where students could potentially go from sixth grade, seventh grade to eighth grade through the program. And then we'll have to give it a deeper analysis. As long as we're continuing to see gains throughout, we know that we're on the right track. Could we do better? Yes. Are we going to see leaps and bounds in the next year? I don't know. I'm hopeful. But it's not going to happen without a lot of hard work and effort.
Prachee tells us repeatedly we need 3 years of data before we have a trend.
We do. And I just want to add that the middle school second scoop analysis is still in process. It's hard to find matched groups of students. But to go back to the predictability, the two tests that we use are MAP in reading and math, and we use FAST, curriculum-based measure for reading, and both of them have 0.8 to 0.95 correlation of predictability with MCA, and one is perfect. So it's very good. It's as good as it can be. And I also want to, it would be remiss of me not to make a comment about when we look at the data and say, what can we do? We tend to immediately go to the technical side of the problem, which we have been doing for years and years and years, and haven't made much of a dent. So our whole effort with equity coaching and equity work is really to start with ourselves and understand who we are as racial beings, and that might seem a little strange, but I think that more and more, as we are talking about the racial achievement gap, to not talk about race seems strange. So to understand who each person is as a racial being and how a teacher is when he or she shows up in the classroom, because if there's a gap between our beliefs and our results, because when we look at those results, all of us, you're asking these questions because they're in conflict with your beliefs that every student can achieve. So to explain that, I can only say either we say it's genetic, out of control, out of our control, which we don't agree with, then we have to say it is either our beliefs or our practice or both. And so we look at practice much more easily. That's been our training. But looking at beliefs is very necessary, and I think we are learning to do that and understand where our practice may not be aligned with our beliefs.
It's just because of what Prachee was just saying, I won't interrupt anymore. The numbers say exactly what you were saying. We know how to teach 75% of the white kids, right? And we do that very well and straight across the board. But it's that rest of them that we're not doing very well with. And that's, I think, what you were saying is we have to look back into the beliefs that we have as opposed to the way that we're, and the way that we're teaching them. But I agree.
Thank you.
Karen.
And one thing that the data never shows us is we're not talking about the same cohort of kids each time, and it can't account for the kids who move in and move out. And so I think we do a very, very good job with what we have and who we get, but as I understand the MCAs and look at it as a statewide issue, it's not just a St. Louis Park issue, it's the entire state of Minnesota. And I was at an MSBA meeting earlier this month, and the state demographer did an analysis of the state demographic changes, and it's very clear this is a Minnesota problem, and we haven't really had diversity or racial diversity since, it started tracking in the 1970s. So we've got to think about, we've been doing the way of teaching for a long, long time. Now we're in the process of looking at it from an equity standpoint and how that's going to change, because most of our teachers are white and we have great teachers, but we need to give them some new tools to teach the kids we've got. And I think we are on a good track to make progress.
Bruce.
I was at that same MSBA at a different session that Julie actually kicked off. And it was really excellent because it brought out the math guy in me, just because it talked about testing. Obviously, one test does not answer all these questions. The scores you just saw, all measurements have error. And there's enough error in those things to say you really didn't see a whole lot of diversity there. Now, to Ken's point, exactly from top to bottom, from our white kids to our black kids, when you look at that, something's missing. I mean, we've been trying for years, just as Prachee said, to meet this need with technical approaches. One of the things the MSBA meeting brought out was that here's the approach, and oh, by the way, when you speak to our students equipped for learning, and the 3 points they brought out there was commitment to learning, positive identity, and social competence. And just before we came into our meeting, we were talking to our IB students, and I had a wonderful conversation with one of our juniors who will be a senior this year. And one of the discussions as we were walking upstairs was, how would you like to be in a classroom where you're the only black or brown face and the rest of the kids are all white? And how do you deal with that when you're in a classroom? And part of what we've been trying to do, one of the measures that I think we've been fairly good at here, is getting our black and brown students into our IB and AP classes. but we still don't have many kids, black or brown, in our IB diploma program. And so that's the place where I think we just getting back to equipping our students for learning, getting back to the social aspects of what we need to do here, I think we're doing a good job, but I also think we're a little early in the measuring, and I think there may be some different ways to measure that we need to come up with. And again, I support Ken that a number of our students certainly need these individual development programs so that we don't miss these kids who need this extra help.
Other Nancy. And I'm going to, Superintendent Metz has been kind of elbowing me, so I'll let him, or.
Nicely.
Yes, talk afterwards. Do you want to?
Go ahead, Nancy.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to make a couple of comments, and I think the reason we're engaged is there's a 40% gap on average between our students of color and our white students, and that's just not acceptable. And we all know that, and we're all working on it. The other thing that I think our superintendent might have been going to comment on, and I'll let him comment more, but Carrie, I think we've also redesigned our reading intervention programs, and that's going to go forward, and we're going to later on the consent agenda, we're going to approve the hiring of a part-time math coach at the middle school, and we're hoping that that will help make a difference. Those go to perhaps practices, but on beliefs, we're expanding our equity coaching and hoping that that will make a difference. Mm-hmm. Because we need to do better. And what I think I heard you say, Prachee, is that in September we're going to get some more data points in, including the growth data.
Yes.
Because really, when somebody, whether you're trying to become a better hockey player or better math student or better reading student, if you come in below average, in order to get average or better, you have to make more growth than the other kids that are still growing. And so you're playing more than catch up. We're asking for students to achieve more than a year's worth of natural growth, which is asking a lot of our students and a lot of our teachers. And that's hard work. And so it will be good to see that growth data, to see how we're doing in terms of that measure. My one question is, this is an average that we're seeing here. Does the grade data, does the school data, what does that show us? Is it the same as what we're seeing here, or are there wide variations in how we're doing in various pockets around the district?
There are differences by grade level, I'll say that, and differences in schools among grade levels.
And do those differences tell us anything about better practices to be shared, or how we can, you know, learn from, if we're getting better outcomes in some places, what we can learn?
If the differences are systemic, then we should see them every year. That hasn't been the case so far, but it might be in the future, and then we'll be able to say, okay, we have something that looks like it always produces results no matter who the students are in front of us. And that's where it goes back to the belief piece. It's not, I had a better group of students this year. And like you said, this is new work. We've been used to doing things a certain way, but now, in order to meet the needs of our future clients, we need to do things differently.
Superintendent Metz?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Prachee, for your presentation. I wanted to answer Ken's question a little bit on what do we do with this. And I can tell you, in my mind, there are four big chunks of work that I'm focusing on with our team here. The first is to focus on the standards. We have these tests measure how well our students stack up according to the state standards in reading and math. And so we obviously need to make sure that we are teaching the standards, that they are placed in our curriculum properly, and that we're teaching them at the correct level of rigor, in the correct order, in the correct sequence, and all of that. I'll give you a quick example. At the high school math, there are many ways to get through the high school in math. You could take a very rigorous track of math. You could take a medium rigorous class of math. You can take an easier track of math. I think there are 6 or 7 or 8 different ways you can get through the high school and take your math credits. All 6 or 7 are all tracks of students being taught all of the standards that they're all going to be tested on, regardless of what path you take. Path, a better word than track. Not so sure. So it's pretty complicated. It's more complicated than you think. to look at a student go through the secondary school system, and just math standards alone, of all the different pathways you can take to get through the school, are you being taught the standards in all those pathways? We need to make sure that they are, our standards are placed properly in all of our classes across the district. That's a multi-year task. We got to start on it last year. We're working more on it this year. The second area that I really am focusing on is early literacy, because students that can read and pass the reading proficiency test at third grade are going to be much more successful in all their other subjects, including math. So we spend a lot of time revamping all-day kindergarten. This summer we've looked at revamping first grade literacy, our interventions in the early grades. So a great deal of effort into early literacy. The third area is one I already talked about, secondary math, 7th through 12th grade. Starting with standards, we have a math coach now at the middle school. We've realigned some of the courses at the high school. And the fourth area is what Prachee was referring to, is the emotional believing side. And Derek is going to be up here next talking about the QCOMP system and how we've added more equity coaches. Our principals and cabinet members and myself have undergone a great deal of equity work, and we just need to keep working on that, because we have a mostly white staff and about 60% white students in St. Louis Park, so we have to learn how to be just as effective with all students, not just white students. So I would lump it into four big chunks: placing standards, early literacy, secondary math, and our equity work. And that's where we're putting our time and attention right now.
Any remaining questions from the board? All right. Thank you for the presentation, Prachee. And this is critical numbers. It is just one set of numbers, but an important set. And we'll look at other measures as the year goes on. So we'll go on to our next topic, which is the ATPPS from our report from our new ATPPS coordinator, not new to our district, but relatively new in this role. Superintendent, do you have any introduction?
Board, this is Derek Wenneberg, middle school teacher, middle school athletic director, and our ATPPS coordinator. He finished his first year as an ATPPS coordinator last year, did a very good job, and he's come back for another year. So welcome, Derek.
Thank you, Superintendent Metz, and school board and cabinet and all community members. Thank you for your opportunity for me to present what we're doing in our ATPPS program. For those of you that may not know, I'm Derek Wenneberg. I am a middle school teacher, plus an ATPPS coordinator is what my primary role in the district is. The SLP ATPPS stands for Alternative Teacher Performance Pay System. It is commonly known in our district as ATPPS. In the state, is commonly known as quality compensation also, or QCOMP. So people that maybe not sure what that is, if you've seen that in the news or anything like that, that's what we'll be talking about this time. A little bit on the fly, a link between ATPPS and what Prachee just presented. Those board members and cabinet members that were at the strategic planning process, we talked a lot about student intervention, student needs, student resources, a lot of student, which is exactly what we need to be talking about. But one other theme that came out of it was, lots of times we forget about giving resources to the teachers. And ATPPS is that link between what we're doing with the student interventions and student things like that. It is a system that is hopefully coming alongside teachers to provide the resources, the professional development, and ongoing coaching to be able to raise the level of professionalism and just teacher knowledge of how to reach a wide variety of students, especially our students of color. And that's a goal of ATPPS from the onset. We've gone through the last couple of years, we're going through some significant changes and trying out new things, because when a program goes for a while and we're seeing stagnant numbers in our student achievement or leveled off numbers in student achievement, we as our program need to step up and say, okay, what can we do as a better job at preparing those teachers to change that belief system with when it comes to equity or changing the delivery system of how we teach and to reach and engage as many students as possible. So I'm going to give you a brief review of the 14-15 school year, which I submitted to the state of Minnesota, and then a preview of some of the few changes that are coming into the 15-16 school year. First of all, we instituted quite a few changes in going into last fall's school year. Number one, we did hire a new ATP best coordinator, which was myself. It was about a year ago that I was hired, and I hit the ground running. We had a lot to get in place because of some of the major changes that were put in place this last fall. One of the biggest things we did was change the observation form. We used to have a form that had 27 subdomains on it, and teachers that were building instruction leaders and equity coaches were required to observe staff on 20 separate subdomains throughout the school year, and it caused it was a lot to do. It kind of diluted the quality of coaching that was going on because there was so much that a teacher was looking for during those observations. So we made some significant changes that was approved by our lead building instructional leaders and our in the state of Minnesota to really focus on what are the key things that we want teachers to improve on? And a lot of it was geared towards the equity piece and pieces just to improve professional development. So we pared it down to, and actually combined a lot of them actually, into 13 subdomains. So we reduced it from 27 to 13. Now we didn't really dilute it that much because like I said, we combined some together and kind of went through what are the most key components that we needed to focus on for this year. So that was a major change going into this year. To pay for some of the extended equity coaching, we had to eliminate our mentoring program for new teachers through the ATPPS program. Superintendent Metz took on a part of that and put a plan in place for building principals to take on part of that mentoring program going into this 14-15 school year. We expanded our equity coaching model to all sites. The equity coaching model in the 13-14 year was just at the high school. It was well received and something that we wanted to expand to all sites. So we hired an additional equity coach to give us three equity coaches for the 14-15 school year and made equity coaching available at all sites from pre-K all the way to ABE. So they all had access to be able to choose an equity coach. Those were the big changes that we made for the school year in 14-15. Kind of a year in review, the annual report that is sent to the state of Minnesota. One of their big things they're looking for is job-embedded professional development. We do that through our PLCs at each site. They're looking for a set amount of time, about an hour a week, of job-embedded professional development being offered to all our staff, and we continue to meet those state guidelines. All sites are giving teachers that time to be able to look at data that, like Prachee just reported, or work on some of the standards and all sorts of other professional development things. So we are in compliance with that. We expanded our equity coaching model, allow more staff to have more time and focus given to them for coaching. That's one of the benefits of the equity coaching program is having full-time release staff in the buildings as a resource. We also have building instructional leaders, which are not full-time release staff members. They do their observations and their coaching either during a prep time or they get a sub for anywhere from 1 to 3 days for the year to be able to do that coaching with the staff members. The equity coaching pilot program, by having full-time release equity coaches, allows a little bit more time and resource to be put towards some of those staff. We're finding out that that is becoming a big benefit and making a difference in those staff that are choosing that. In the 14-15 school year, we had 150 staff members choose to have an equity coach. So that came out to about a 50-to-1 ratio for the caseload for the equity coaches, and then the rest of the staff chose to remain with the bill. Each staff member has to write a professional development plan, or PDP. This year we had 61% of our staff meet the standard. to that they met the standard for student achievement in their classroom. A big portion of that was the high school wrote a single PDP goal this year based on F grades given in the classroom and things like that, and they did not achieve their goal, so that's a big portion of why we only are at 61%, because we had an entire school not make it. Another reason was we really made a push working with Kerry Ross and Nate Tangen through the union to really shore up some of those professional development plans and make them SMART goals and really challenge teachers to grow. In the past, sometimes these professional development plans were up to the teachers. They had to show student achievement, but we really wanted to challenge them this year, and a lot of teachers took that and said, yes, I need to grow. And because of that, like I said, we didn't have 100% of our staff make their goal because they really pushed themselves. And through that process, we hope that growth happened. Trying to achieve that goal and trying to push student expectations even higher, we're hoping that just the way they teach and what their goals are push them to become better teachers.
Hey, Derek?
Yes.
When you say that, so 39% were not eligible at all for this portion of the...
Yes, so
the 61% all got all of it, or they got potentially some fraction of it?
Yeah, thank you. Okay. A teacher gets 500, they get two, the total, I guess, performance pay that they would get are eligible for is $2,000. $500 of that is based on whether or not they reach their student achievement goal, professional development goal. So 61% of our staff met that criteria of receiving $500 for meeting that goal. 39%, like you said, did not meet that criteria. Does that answer your question?
Not fully.
Okay.
So the 61% didn't necessarily get all five. That, my question is, did the 61% necessarily get all $500?
No.
Or they got...
Well, yes, 61% received the $500.
Okay.
That's what it is.
So it's all or nothing.
Yes, all or nothing.
That's,
yes.
I should have just said, yes. Is it all
Thank
or nothing?
Thank you.
That's what I meant.
Yes, so. 61% received it, 39% did not. So for the professional development goal. Yeah.
Thank you.
89% of our staff met the standard to earn performance pay based on their observation results. All staff members must be proficient throughout the three observations they get through the year in those 13 subdomains. And if they can show proficiency by the end of the year, then they've met the standard according to our plan to for the observation that they're proficient in those subdomains that we've chosen. So 89% met that. 95% of those that met it were tenured staff, and 80% of our probationary staff met that standard. The last part of our performance pay is site goal achievement, and Prachee just gave some data on that. I didn't have that data at this time, so we have not determined at each site whether or not they made their goal. That is a portion of what each teacher's $2,000 that is based on that, so I do not have that data at this time. Impact of equity coaching pilot this year. Like I stated before, we had 150 staff choose to be coached by an equity coach. 215 staff chose to be coached by a Bill. We did a mid-year survey of how things were going. 62% of all our staff, whether they had a Bill or equity coach, stated that they would like to choose an equity coach for this coming school year. Yes.
Can you just briefly explain the difference?
Sure. An equity coach is a full-time release staff member that is observing a minimum of three times a year, doing a pre-conference and a post-conference. But because they're a full-time release, they're also housed in the buildings as a resource to go in and sub for a teacher, so that teacher can then go maybe watch an exceptional teacher to get some more ideas. That's an example. Or they can do some research for a teacher. So we've expanded the responsibilities of what a building instructional leader is. Building instructional leader's responsibility is the same thing: pre-conference, observation, post-conference. But that's pretty much the key. That's all they're doing. That's all they have time for doing. So equity coach is expanding the amount of resources that a teacher can have. And an equity coach, because of the name, obviously, and the training they have, has a much more equity lens going through what they're doing. Bills have minimal training on an equity lens. They try to add some of those stuff in. and they do the best they can with the time and resources they have. But like Superintendent Metz said, having the equity coaches, it really puts the focus on, are we reaching our students of color in the classroom, and what are the resources we can do? Because they've got extensive training on meeting those needs. Thank you. Let's see. Staff coached by Bill. So we on the survey, they had to say, were you coached by a Bill or coached by an equity coach? 40% of all the staff coached by a Bill said that next year they would like to try an equity coach. 40% would stay with a Bill. 39% would choose an equity coach for the 15-16 school year. So there is an interest, and people see the, I guess, the benefit of having an equity coach in their instruction or classroom. We noticed that. That's why we did the mid-year survey, is to kind of see, where are we at with this? Are people buying into it? Do they feel it's necessary? Do they feel that there's an added benefit? And from these numbers, we can see that people that had Bills, about 39% said, hey, I would like to try an equity coach the next year. Go ahead.
So I was able to do some high-level math in my head here and notice that that only adds up to 79%. Is that...
Yeah.
Are those undecideds or no answers? Or
no, so that last percentage is people that say we don't care, either one is fine, or they just didn't answer. So thank you for doing the math. Right. Thank you. And I was going to add that, but you reminded me. Thank you. Kind of the more eye-opening thing is staff coached by equity coaches. 89% said they would stay with an equity coach that year. So they saw the importance of that, and only 3% of those staff would choose a Bill for the next year. And obviously that does not add up to 100%, so the rest of them were undecided or didn't care either way. So based on this data that we received, and just by observation and talking to staff members, the lead Bill team, which is the governing body and the deciding body, decided that we wanted to expand the equity coaching model if we could. We got approval from the state of Minnesota to look into extending another year of equity coaching model, but they recommended that we have the capability of at least having 50% of our staff have the opportunity to be coached by an equity coach. So to be able to do that, we had to we have to going into next year do a few more changes, and we've moved forward with some of those, and that's kind of the approval we're looking for tonight. So ATPS plans for 15-16. We hired the additional 3 equity coaches. 4 of the 6 coaches will be paid out of the ATPPS budget. That's what we can afford to be budget, and we worked with Superintendent Metz to fund the additional 2 equity coaches that we have. So going into next year, we're going to have 6 equity coaches. The benefit of that is equity coaches will be more site-based. One of the biggest downfalls of expanding to all sites but only having 3 equity coaches is that they were bouncing from building to building. And the goal of that is them to be housed at 1 or 2 buildings, so they're there for a resource for a teacher when they need them. If a teacher had a rough day and needs some advice from an equity coach, if they're in that building and they're a resource, that's what we wanted to happen, and that's what we're trying to make happen next year. That's what made it successful at the high school year one, was those equity coaches were here. They could go into a classroom. They could be available during prep times or before or after school as a resource and as a sounding board saying, I'm really struggling with this. How do I reach these kids? You know, and that's ideally what we want, is to have that. So that's we're expanding that to be able to give that opportunity for equity coaches to be more site-based and not have to travel between 4 buildings, which is a difficult thing. Also, because we eliminated the mentoring role in 14-15, that was a big issue for a lot of the new staff. It was kind of a hole that we have to plug a little bit. Just new staff coming in to understand the ATPPS system and just understand what it takes to be a teacher in St. Louis Park. And so with the hiring of additional equity coaches, we've also slightly reduced their caseload a little bit to give them more opportunities to reach out and do a little bit of mentoring role with some of the new staff members, the capability of doing that and bringing back that to an extent. It's kind of a work in process. We're not sure exactly how we're going to do that, but that's what we're going through in the process. So there's not a lot of changes going into next year for the program, except for expanding the equity coaches. At this time, at the end of the year, we asked all staff members to what would be their preference again, Do you want to choose an equity coach or do you want to choose a bill? They're both available to all staff, and we have at this time approximately 220 to 250, depending on how many new staff we have come in, have chosen equity coach. That leaves around 100 to 120 staff that are still going to be observed by a bill at this time. And as moving forward, like I said, this is a pilot program, so we're constantly trying to think of ideas to make it better, to make it stronger, and in the future we need to decide, is this where we want to go with our ATPPS program, to go to full-time release equity coaches to help reduce that racial achievement gap and just to increase our student achievement and our teacher professionalism as a whole. So the biggest change, like I said, is just adding the addition of three additional equity coaches, and I mean that's really the only change we're making for going into the next year. Questions?
Jim.
Just to your last point, just talk about measurements then, if that's the goal. And have you thought ahead on how you're going to measure and what you're going to measure? Or,
yeah.
You know, and you measure the teachers, or is it ultimately the kids then, or both, or how?
Yeah, I mean, that's always the million-dollar question, is how do you take a program that, or any program that we do in the district, and compare it to, you know, overall, if our MCA scores aren't improving, is it because this program's not working or that program? Right now, our measurements are serving staff as far as growth over time. I mean, have they changed their mindsets? Have they changed the way the instruction's happening? Are they doing better PDP, professional development goals, and challenging themselves with that? Those are the measurements we can. Obviously, every program gets measured whether or not we reach our overall student achievement goal. And we're hoping through addition of equity coaches and having an equity lens over the next few years that we'll start seeing that gap lessen. So those are the measurement points that we're going by right now. But like I said, if you have a million-dollar answer, call me anytime. So.
Yeah, call all of us.
Yeah.
Questions? Kim?
An answer to that for MBE or anything?
To... Ken is asking about MDE's measurements of equity, which is primarily using our four multiple measures, the MCA scores, the high school graduation, but achieve a proficiency and then achievement gap closure, the breakouts by demographics, so. And individual growth. That's and just for everybody else, that's what Prachee Mukherjee and Kerry Ross were answering, who instantly had that off the top of their heads, not me.
And my question to you, I guess, those individual goals are measured by them, the individuals, or by someone else that looks at their individual goals?
Sure. The lead building and structure and equity coaches go through all the staff's individual goals, making sure they're a SMART goal, making sure they are timely. They're not just one test given randomly throughout the year. It's something that's growth over time. And I know in the past we've sent back a lot of goals saying, nope, that's not good enough. Try again. And with help to do that. So we are very intentionally looking at the goals that the teachers are setting to make sure that it is impacting their student achievement in their classroom.
Are there any other questions?
I have a question statement. As you were going through your presentation, you said that you're taking out the mentoring, and that concerned me in that earlier in the years, one of the issues was retention of teachers of color was they didn't have a good foundation or mentoring system or something to lean on when they ran into issues. So that was a concern of mine, but then you came back at the end and you said the equity coaches would have that piece, but you also said that the principals would have that piece. Is it going to be both, or are you going to more focus it on to the equity coaches to mentor to the individuals, which would encompass the question that I actually have?
So right now we don't have the overall plan in place of how the mentoring is going to work. We want to make sure that the equity coaches are mentoring them, at least in how our QComp ATPPS system works and the equity piece too and getting there. Now, specific building-wide things may still be on the principal's table as, you know, procedural things in the buildings and things like that. But we need to do something, like you said. By eliminating that last year, there was just a gap there, and a lot of that was one of the biggest, you know, when we did the survey, people put comments on there too, and that was one of the biggest comments is we need something to help the new teachers, and that's why we're trying to come up with a solution to work together with the principals and collaborate with them to make sure that we're not, like you said, we're not leaving them behind. So,
and I would really love to encourage the equity coaches to mentor. That would, I'd love to see that. The other question I had was, I know this ties back into what the MCAs. I was wondering if there were a way to measure how many of the instructors that had equity coaches and the ones that have the students that aren't attaining the 800 some odd kids that are not achieving goals. Is that some way you can measure if it's being successful, non-successful, something in that area?
You know, I've thought of that. It's hard because multiple, I mean, those students have teachers that have, I mean, it's actually probably a little bit easier in the elementary level if they have a home core teacher. Secondary level is difficult because they may have seven different teachers, which half and half. So that's something I could work with Prachee in that and just pull out some of that data just to see if there is a difference. And hopefully we can, by expanding our equity coaching model, that would be, that we would see a difference in that. So thank you, Ken.
Yeah, just a data mining type of thing would be kind of interesting to see what it is, not take any action, but
yep.
Play.
I agree.
I just wrote it down.
Yep.
Any other questions? I've just got one. A year ago when we had this presentation, or last year or two, I've understood we were the only district in the state doing anything like this. This was innovative mm-hmm. and truly deserving of the word unique. Are we still the only district doing anything like this, or is there anybody else following our lead?
Officially, yes. Unofficially, yes. There are people looking at our program and implementing bits and pieces of it. It hasn't, you know, I know just talking, just even some of the new equity coaches that we've hired coming from other districts and things like that, that they've looked at this and a piece of that. The state is looking at what we're doing. That's why they're well behind us saying, yes, keep this going, and because we want to see how well it works. That's kind of the next piece is if we do move beyond the pilot and decide that this is the best process for ATPPS to move on, then we can start, you know, because it's still a pilot program, we're still trying to collect that data, whether or not it's going to work, then we can start maybe expanding it and helping other districts and doing this so we can start, you know, use this program that we came up with to just help all students. So.
Good, and I'm glad to see that it's expanding, and thank you very much for your presentation and all your work during the year.
Thank you.
So, thank you. We'll move on to the next topic, which is the strategic plan update, and our superintendent will move to the podium, I guess, and I appreciate that these are quick changes as each laptop gets connected. I'm Tom Marble's not.
There he is, right there.
There he is, Tom. Working well? Okay. I like how this is going. And it'll be easier for those of you who occasionally come to 354 our meetings. You can now see a screen in front of you, at least in front to the side, and you won't have to turn around every time there's a presentation.
Good evening again, board members. I'm here to do a quick update on the strategic plan. A little bit has happened since we last met. I'm going to begin by just reminding you of the four strategies that we are focusing on. Nothing has changed here, but just as a reminder, strategy one is focused on teaching and learning, grounded in our belief that all students can achieve our mission. We will continually evaluate and systemically implement student outcomes by aligning instruction, curriculum, and assessment in a culturally relevant manner. Strategy two is about our structures and systems. We will align our structures and systems to our core values and develop and support all employees in order to achieve our mission and mission outcomes. Strategy three is about community collaboration. We will collaborate with our diverse communities authentically and systemically to build collective ownership and accountability to achieve our mission and mission outcomes in accordance with our core values. And strategy four is about facilities. We will ensure that our facilities are consistent with the needs of our learners and our community. So we have to select results under each strategy to complete in the first year of the five-year plan. And we being the cabinet and the principals, met on July 20th. We took a day to look at all the results. There are 19 results spread through the four strategies, and select three that we want to complete in the first year.
Can you explain again for a moment what a result is? These were developed by the strategic planning group, and
yes, so a result is something that we want to accomplish, a result, by the end of a one-year time period. So of the 19 results that are spread throughout the four strategies, by the end of the 5 years, we have to complete all 19. So we're taking some at a time, some the first year, some the second year, some the third year, and by the end of the 5 years, all 19 will be accomplished. So the first year, we selected three of the 19. I got some feedback from the actual core team that wrote the 19 results or approved the 19 results. I also got feedback from our district team, our principals and our cabinet members who are going to be responsible to help carry out this work. So putting those two pieces together, here are the three that were selected. From strategy one, teaching and learning, we selected result two. Result two said we will utilize an implementation plan intended to increase the capacity of educators to measure learners' knowledge and skills, align culturally relevant instructional practices, and ensure all students achieve. A more simple way of saying this, I rewrote it in my language, we will create and utilize a plan to grow our teachers' ability to teach in a culturally relevant manner. So this is calling us to have a plan to grow the capacity of our teachers so that they are able to teach in a culturally relevant manner that's meaningful to the students.
So is the result the creation of the plan by the end of the year?
The creation and the implementation.
Oh, and implementation.
Of the plan.
Okay.
So the finished product would be, here's the plan, and we're using it, and here's how we're using it. We spent a lot of time in the core team talking about every word in here. For example, what are culturally relevant practices? So one of the first things this team has to do is to define what is a culturally relevant practice so that we can create a plan and begin utilizing a plan to help our teachers be able to accomplish that. So that's one we're taking on this year. The second one we're taking on this year also falls under the teaching and learning category. Probably no surprise since we've spent most of this meeting talking about teaching and learning activities. And it's result four. We will continually use evidence of student achievement, specifically focusing on our students of color and diverse populations, to inform instructional practices that transform beliefs, actions, values for data-driven, relevant student learning. Here's my other way of saying what this means to me. We are going to use evidence of student achievement to make quick and meaningful instructional decisions. So we've talked a lot about MCA data. MCA data is what I would call autopsy data. The year's over, we look at it, and we see how we did. It's not very informative for the day-to-day in the classroom, informing the teacher, student can do this today, so I'm going to teach this tomorrow, or for grade levels or schools to make decisions on the fly during the school year. This Wednesday, 2 days from today, we have leadership teams from all of the schools meeting to design a plan to do just this. How does a school collect data on the fly as they're teaching and make changes to how they do business? So another way of saying this is we are going to use evidence of student achievement to make quick and meaningful instructional decisions in real time. And each school is going to have a plan of how to do that. The third result that we selected for this year is in the category or in the strategy three, community collaboration, our community understands our mission and our core values. Now, at first glance, this sounds like we're going out and we're spreading the word of the strategic plan, which we are. But the group that worked on this also wanted to make a point to emphasize that this should not just be a one-way conversation, and that we will, in fact, spend just as much time listening and gathering feedback from our community as we will be sharing information. So we're going to be sharing information about the strategic plan and what we are about as a school district, about our mission and core values, but we're also going to be listening and learning from the groups that we meet with. We also identified some year two results. Now, we don't have teams assigned to these yet. We have teams assigned to all of the first year results so that they can begin that work right off the bat this year. But we identified the year two results, and we picked four of them for year two. Strategy one, teaching and learning, we will utilize a consistent and defined process to identify and act on learner outcomes to eliminate racial predictable patterns of student achievement as defined by our mission. This, to me, is the one that speaks about outcomes. We need to have our outcomes placed properly in all of our courses and all of our curriculum across the district. That's a year two result. Another year two result is under structures and systems. We have employees that are effective and accountable in their work to support core values to achieve our mission. This one was highly sought after by both the core team and the people from inside the organization. What this means to me is we are an organization with over 650 employees, and those employees need to make sure that each and every employee clearly knows their job requirements, what their assignment is, who they're supervised by, and make sure that they're evaluated regularly and properly. So this is more of an internal structures and systems result. A third result for year two is under community collaboration, result one. We will systemically seek multiple perspectives from our diverse community to fulfill our mission. We need a systemic way to ensure that we will always do this. We do this at times and in places. But we have to have a system that we can look to that will say, every year we are reaching out, getting multiple perspectives from our diverse community to inform us about how we're doing. And under strategy four, facilities, this is going to be the most challenging one to complete in 2 years. We have created world-class centers of excellence that are welcoming, visually appealing, accessible, flexible, healthy, safe, and secure, which will achieve the needs of our diverse learning community in accordance with our mission. We're going to be doing quite a bit of facility work over the next 2 years, and I believe we'll be designing a new facility plan. I'm not sure we'll have a finished product at the end of year two, but we'll definitely have a plan by the end of year two. And finally, I wanted to show you the timeline. So the year one results all have teams built around them. They're going to be meeting in October, November. In December, they're going to be checking in with me so I can see what progress they're making on their work. In January, they'll meet again. In February, we'll bring the whole group back together that met in July, the internal group of administrators, to check in with each other to see what progress we're making. They'll keep meeting in March and April, and then by May, we have to come back to the core team and report our year one results. How did we do on those first three? At the same time, about halfway through this year, we'll kick off the second year teams and get them a head start into their work. Much of that work has already begun, but we'll formally create teams for the second year work about halfway through this year, get them begin meeting. They'll meet with me before they leave for the summer, and I'm sure we'll keep working over the summer so that when they come back for the second year, they will have a good head start on their second year results. So in summary, we've now selected the three results that we're going to complete the first year and the four results that we're going to complete the second year. The other thing that's going to be happening this year that is not on this chart is we're going to be working on the evaluation of the strategic plan. When the core team met last spring, they did not update the mission outcomes, which is really the evaluation of the mission statement. How do we know if we're doing what we say we're doing? And one of the things that we have to do this year before the core team comes back together in May is we have to bring to that core team a first draft of what the mission outcomes could look like, of how we evaluate our success on the entire plan. And then the core team is going to edit them and rewrite them and approve them in May. So the evaluation of the entire strategic plan, that decision will be made in May of this next spring.
Okay, thank
questions.
You. Questions. Board members, questions. Nancy.
Rob, I just following up on some of our conversations during your evaluation, I was a little surprised to hear that the facilities was not going to start until halfway through this year. But is that going to work on your time frame, you know, to figure that all out? Because I thought you said facilities was going to partially drive technology. And I'm just questioning the timeline and want to hear a little more.
Yep, you are very observant. That's a good question. I'm planning on talking to the board about facilities probably in a pre-meeting before one of our two September meetings. And you're right. The design team, what we used to call a facility task force, will have to get together before January. They'll have to be formed early in the fall.
Other questions or comments? Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
That presentation. Our next discussion item is the Minnesota State High School League membership resolution. And this included a request that all, or an expectation that all school board members watch a video, a training video called Why We Play, which was very, I hope we will ask if everybody did. I certainly did. And emphasizes that winning is not the only reason we play, and I thought it was good. Cindy, you've brought this requirement forward to us. Cindy Bennett, is there anything else that you need to let us know about?
No, thank you, Chair Schweitzer. I did speak to Director of Athletics Andy Ewald, and he helped us get this video to the board, and he's looked at the form, and as long as everyone has assured that they've viewed it, that's will be all that we need when we sign the resolution for membership.
Okay, this will be on our action agenda. Is there any comments or thoughts that anybody, Nancy and then Ken?
Yeah, I watched the video. It was quite good. It talked about coaches who are transformational and help not only teach the sport and the goal to win, but also the fundamental life skills and values that are built into sports and keeping kids connected to the school and caring about their academics so they can play. I mean, I think all of those are at work here. What it led me to want to ask is if we can think about an agenda item down the road whenever the timing works. I would like to hear what we're doing. I would like to hear how we're recruiting our coaches, how we're training our coaches, what kind of a model are we implementing, and see what we're doing in that vein here, not just see the video, but what are we doing and can we improve? What do we think? Are we getting turnover? How is it working for our students? If we do surveys, that might be an interesting feedback that we could have. I don't know what is happening there anymore. I used to.
Ken.
I was wondering, is this video going to be a requirement for the coaches then to view and to adhere to?
That's a good question. Cindy, do you know the answer to that?
Director Ewald did tell me that all the coaches are required to watch this as well, actually prior to this year. The Minnesota State High School League has just made this requirement and request for school boards this year.
So good. Yeah.
Director Ewald also asked me to share with you folks in the audience that this is nothing new to St. Louis Park. This is Park's pride, Park's model, Park's MO, to quote Andy. So he felt very comfortable of not taking an hour and a half of your time to, you know, to talk about every little thing, because this is what Park has done for years. So he wanted me to share that with you folks.
To clarify, I would think it could be done in 15 to 20 minutes.
And the video itself is only 10, but it was worth watching. Anything else? All right, we'll go on to our next item, which is the selection of the date for the public hearing on truth and taxation, an annual issue. So Sandy Celine, can you tell us which date we have chosen?
Yes, this is something we have to do every year about this time. We select our date for our truth and taxation hearing to create the planning stages for putting that in the paper and inviting those to come in and make comments if they feel they need to. And the date that we selected is December 14th at 6:30.
And that's our regular regular school board meeting at 7 o'clock. So for the last few years, we've scheduled it at half an hour before the scheduled meeting, and we'll explain the levy proposal at that time and take any questions. So any questions or discussion from board members? All right, we'll approve that on our action agenda. The last discussion item is a long one, but on the other hand, somewhat mundane. It's the policy development first readings of the series 200 policies for the board, which is basically our operational series. It is officially submitted by our vice chair and by Cindy Bennett as the executive administrative assistant, secretary to the school board. I did not see any changes in any of the proposed policies, or did I miss something there?
There were no changes that I brought forward. They were last approved last year. We brought this series. We're just starting to kick off the year with the 200 series. Director Gores tells me that she found a few things that might need some discussion.
All right. I had looked to make sure on several of them that we had the version we approved last year, or by the date. But Nancy, what did you note?
Yeah, let me try to go through this sort of quickly. Policy 202, School Board Officers, under Clerk, talks about keeping the record of all meetings in the books provided. Do we have books provided? I mean, I'm wondering about deleting that phrase, or...
The books provided are requested by law for the all agendas and minutes that I keep.
That's what I needed to know. On 205, there's open and closed meetings, and under part four, there's an option for holding our meetings at school sites in conjunction with site-based program presentations. I would be inclined to delete that in conjunction with site-based program presentations. I mean, if we ever wanted to meet at a school site, it seems maybe we just want to do it.
205, what section again?
4.1.
That makes sense to me. Odds are we might ask for a school-based, site-based presentation, but we ought to be able to do it just because. Mm-hmm. So,
And then, Cindy, you and I can talk, but on the second page of that, and I think we talked about this last year, but it might not have been picked up. In policy 203.2, we lay out our typical agenda. In policy 205, we lay out our typical agenda. They don't match up. So I think they need to match up. The 203.2 is what we typically do. This one misses communications, and it has a typo under review and approval of agenda.
Jim.
I would follow up on that, too, is I think it's switched since this time. We don't do the approval of prior meeting minutes right at the beginning anymore. We do it as part of our consent agenda. We don't call it out anymore, and I don't totally recall why we did that, but our policy, I mean, ought to follow our practice, or our practice ought to follow our policy, better yet. But
I would agree, and that was in 203.2, where we still listed where we do our minutes in the wrong spot now. We've made a shift.
Thank you.
Yes, that we did discuss those last year, so let's make sure we get the right items in there. Good. Anything else anybody caught?
Yep, in the next page under meeting agenda.
Next page, which policy are you in?
Same policy.
Would be 205. Okay.
In the meeting agenda, it says the agenda shall be delivered to the homes of the board members. Now that we're electronic, I think we could just say shall be delivered to the board members and cut out the to the homes.
Makes sense.
And then I would just remind us, having read all these, that the meeting agenda says we're supposed to look at our annual board agenda calendar with major topics identified. I don't recall having done that in recent years, so we should, whenever the organizational meeting comes up, that might be a time to, or however else we want to do that, but we're not doing that. And if we're going to, I don't recall doing that recently.
I don't think we did in the last year or so, but not long before that, we did create a tentative version that I update periodically and will pass on to my successors. So including that in the January organizational meeting as just a starting point, things are not identical from year after year, but it gives us a list of things we want to cover and tentative times to cover them based on past practice. So let's include that. Anything else, Nancy? And I do appreciate, I thought about going through really and comparing with last year's language, and I thought, no, Nancy will do it.
I do too, Director Gross. I read them all, but I missed those. Thank you.
Well, the good news and the bad news is that my work computer wouldn't start up this morning. So while I was waiting for it to fix itself, I had time to look at these. The other one is 208. And I thought we talked about this last year and agreed to delete this, and it's still here. It's 208, it's number three, development of policy. The first sentence reads, the school board has jurisdiction to legislate policy for the school district with the force and effect of law. And I pretty strongly believe with the force and effect of law should be deleted. We are adopting policy, it is guideline. Some of it might be included in state law, but some of it is not. And I just spent 3 days of training with people reminding me policy is not law. So I don't think we should automatically say all our policy is law, because it's not.
Again, I think that makes sense, and I remember a discussion on that. So we'll add that. Cindy, are you catching all these? Because I did not write them down.
Yes, I am. Thanks.
Thank you.
That was it for me.
Okay.
While we're waiting, so I know now that we're getting our stuff uploaded, sometimes we don't see redlining. Now, so did the MSBA not have any redline changes for the year?
There were no changes from last year to this year.
So would we be able to see redlining? I know sometimes on Apple you can't see redline documents.
You know what I'm saying? You close it and reopen it, and
Or you do it through PDF.
It's hard. It's easier on a PC. You're right. But
so for future, like next time we see these, if we just show the pages so we can see what the red line changes are before adoption, I guess we should check to make sure that.
He would like to have a track changes version, and it's just on Macs. It's sometimes not as easily visible. So could we get a few print copies that show the track changes
or
so we could
PDF.
Or PDF.
So if I PDF with the red, it should.
I think
come.
You PDF with red line, those work. But I know I've had this with these in particular.
I don't think I've brought any PDFs since we've been on board book, so I'll try it next time and see how it works.
Well, that's essentially what board book is doing, making them into a PDF, so it should be able to handle them first. Yeah. Okay, any other? Thank you, Nancy, for that. Those are important items. And to have straight for the future. Anybody else catch anything that they would like to propose as a change? All right, then we'll go on to our consent agenda, which does not have discussion. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Motion by Bruce, second by Ken. All in favor of the motion to approve the consent agenda, please say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Motion carries 7-0.
Julie.
I think we talked about her before, didn't we? Yeah. We have a retirement noted there, Gloria Wolf, but we recognized her back in June with our other retirements. It is worth noting now or later that we have a number of new staff. The consent agenda is filled with appointments, and we certainly welcome all of our new teachers and other staff to the district this fall. So let's go into our action agenda. The first item is to approve the date for the truth and taxation hearing of December 14th, 2015. It's recommended the school board approve the truth and taxation hearing date for Monday, December 14th, 2015 at 6:30 p.m. Is there a motion to approve that?
So moved.
Moved by Joe, second by?
Second.
Second by Ken. Is there any discussion? All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Second is on the State High School League resolution. It's recommended that the school board approve the resolution for the 2015-16 membership in the Minnesota State High School League and affirmation of viewing the Why We Play video as presented. Motion to approve?
So
motion by Karen.
Second.
Tied second by Bruce and Jim, but Jim just tossed it over to Bruce, so second by Bruce. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? And last on the action agenda is approval of the ATPPS plan. It's recommended that the school board approve the 2015-16 ATPPS plan as presented. Is there a motion to approve the plan? So moved by Karen. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Joe. Any discussion? All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? Motion carries and the plan is approved. Communications and transmittals. Bruce.
I was just at the Guthrie Theater and this past weekend and saw Music Man. And it was quite good. In fact, it was one of the better performances I've ever seen at the Guthrie. And it almost matched the junior high performance we had a couple of years ago. My point is that watching these actors on stage at the Guthrie, they were all mic'd, and rather beautifully mic'd. And I didn't bring up under our little discussion we had over facilities here, because it's not really strategic. In fact, at this point, it is very tactical. I am anxious to hear how our mic'ing process on the stage at the high school is going.
You're encouraging me to check into this tomorrow.
Yes, please.
I don't think that was encouraging.
I believe this is the week. I believe this is the week where it might be being installed. Plan is that it will all be installed by the fall play, so we're anxious to see it. Tom Marble is around here somewhere, hiding behind us, and he actually would know the exact answer to that.
The future is close. Others, Karen.
I wanted to point out Children First asset number 37, personal power. We had a number of middle school and high school kids working with Karen Atkinson to develop a list of ways that adults can make an impact on all of the 40 assets. This is all kid-driven. And so personal power, the kids are telling us what they need and how they need it. But an interesting thing, earlier in August, I had a chance to start the three-day series with Dr. Heather Hackman and a number of our St. Louis Park staff for the WEMEP Racial Justice, and that too relates to personal power. We have, and a number of the people were on the strategic planning committee. Lisa brought her whole team. Chris Weaver was there, a number of people from the high school and middle school. So we have people throughout the system who are also going to be working on their own personal power to create equity within our system. And I was really impressed with the number of St. Louis Park people at that first of three all-day sessions with Dr. Heather Hackman.
Joe.
See, today is Monday, August 10th. Tomorrow is Tuesday, August 11th, which is a mayoral primary here in St. Louis Park, so I encourage you to get out and vote. Knowing that the city is very tied to the schools, and so I encourage you to do that. Additionally, on Wednesday, August 12th, is the Children First Barbecue at Oak Hill Park at lunchtime. And so I think what I see here on my phone is that you need to register for the event just to make sure that they have enough food. So do that as well.
Others, Nancy?
Yeah, sitting here at our spots tonight was the new 2015-2016 City School calendar. And Sarah, I'm sure you were involved in that. It really looks good. Can you comment a little bit about when it's going to, without making promises we can't keep, when we anticipate it's going to be mailed out and arriving at homes, and how we got the artwork for this one?
Certainly. Director Gores, the City School calendar is arriving in mailboxes throughout St. Louis Park this week. If you don't receive one, there are going to be copies at various city buildings and school buildings as well. And we will be posting it online as well. Just the calendar pages. We recognize that many families would like to have multiple copies of the calendar. We certainly can't provide those due to budget, but we certainly can provide pages for downloading and printing. That certainly do the job. The artwork is all courtesy of a juried competition we did with Health in the Park. It's all around being healthy, and various art forms. You'll see photos, you'll see original artwork, watercolors, some great sketches, really great community artwork coming together for our calendar this year, and all around the theme of Health in the Park.
Wonderful. Anybody else? Yes.
Okay. Football season, at least practice, started today. And we have practice for fall practice these next 2 weeks. And then we have a game on Saturday the 22nd. I do believe it's here in the stadium, but I'll have to check up on that. But it's not in our calendar. I don't know if you... So you'll have to look on gopark.org and you'll see the football schedule there.
Our next board meeting will be after the first day of school. So, I was going to say that it's... Why don't you say what you were thinking?
Okay, I was just going to say, we don't meet again before the first day of school. So two things. One, I absolutely love how people in the park really welcome all our students as they head back to school and as they're waiting for the bus and as they're at the school and as they're coming home and greeting them, smiling at them, not making them nervous, but making them feel appreciated and cared for. And so I just want to thank you in advance because I think it's a great thing I see happening every year during this first week in particular. And the second thing that I was going to say is our September school board calendar meeting schedule is different. And I just wanted people to be aware that our next meeting is not the second Tuesday like it would typically be. It's the third and fourth Tuesdays. We're sort of meeting back to back on the 21st and 28th in September. I won't be here on the 21st, but I will be thinking of you all.
Anybody else? The only other thing I had is that tomorrow, the 11th, is the last day for filing for a school board election. So if you're listening to this on the 11th, it's too late. Oh, 12th. 10th.
Till 5 p.m.
Till 5, that's what I was going to say. If you're listening to it on the 11th in the evening, it's too late. But if you're listening to it today on the 10th live, that is the last opportunity. And I was going to talk about the change in meeting dates. And other than that, I think it's just a welcome to everybody coming back to school now as staff start coming back, and then our students are back on the 8th and the 10th for the kindergartners. And welcome to the 125th year of St. Louis Park Schools. That's pretty amazing, and I think we'll hear about a celebration or two before the year ends done. So if you got great ideas on how to celebrate 125 years of St. Louis Park Schools, let any one of us know. I think Sarah Thompson and Rob Metz are probably great places to, great people to focus those suggestions. So with that, I'll call for a motion to adjourn.
Second.
I think I heard Nancy with a second by Jim. All in favor of adjourning, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? Motion carries. We are adjourned. Good night. We'll see you in September.